What is healed perception? Let's find out as we distill the essence of the teachings of Jesus, Ananda Mahima, Ramana Maharshi, and Longchenpa. We're getting to it right now, as a matter of fact, in the mood of repentance, which means what? We anticipate we're going to have a great insight into how we've been tricked. All right? And that's going to really bug us. So in anticipation of this, we get into this subdued, calm, non-reactive, sober focus. Okay. We anticipate getting stung by this insight because it hurts to see that we've really been tricked, really stupid, been really stupid. All of us have been really stupid. And you see it and you just say, oh my gosh, if I, all this time I've been suffering like terribly and all completely unnecessary. And I could have seen this a long time ago. What? Why? You know, and it stings, really stings. That's why the mood of repentance. Otherwise, you won't get to these insights, or if you do, they'll last for a brief instant, and you'll get, you know, you'll get enraged, kind of, and you have reactions that set you back. So if you get into a mood of repentance, then you're able to withstand these insights, the sting of these insights. I had a couple of these insights today, which are just incredible. I'm telling you, without the mood of repentance, it would have been anguish to realize how incredibly stupid to be duped. Now, how did this happen? I'll share this with you so you can get the idea of this. I remember Jesus saying in A Course in Miracles, you only need a little willingness, just a little willingness, God does the rest. And I said, hey, Jesus, you know, I've had a little willingness all along and I've never gotten anything. What's up? So then I got this realization then that I did get a response, but I backed off of it. So I said, why did I back off? And then it came to me that the ego whispered in my ear saying, hey, look what happened. You had a little bit of willingness, and look what the bliss that you got. It was incredible, right? You really loved it, right? And I said, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I want that again. The ego says, just think about this for a moment, okay? You had a tiny bit of willingness, right? And I said, yeah, just a tiny bit. And you got this wonderful result. And the ego said, just think what you would have if you had a lot of willingness, like more willingness. So we need to work on this, okay? I said, hey, wow, huh, yeah, stupid, fell into stupid, right? We might as well have a sign around our neck saying stupid. Yes, because that is what we are. And to see this, it's like, oh my gosh, because the fact is that was it. I had it in my hands. And I set it down thinking, gee, I need to get more willingness. And then I'll have more. No, I already had the fullness of it. Because a little bit of willingness is all we need. That's it. We get the fullness of it. There isn't more to get. There isn't more to get. So, really, I'm going to write this down here so you can see it. And it's the truth. Okay. So, this is... all right, there you go. Stupid. She all carry this around. She all carry a shirt saying stupid, because we really are stupid. But seeing this and say, oh my gosh, I had it 6 years ago, and I let it go. And all this time, I've been trying to improve myself on the fact I didn't need to at all. And that's, you know, that's a heavy, heavy sting. That's a sharp sting right there. It's just a trick. The ego tricks us. And then it's also, like it says, the same kind of trick. It's like, you have bliss, and the ego says, let's say you had bliss, and the ego says, wow, that's great, you have bliss, that's wonderful, and you only had a little bit of willingness to get this bliss, and just think what a great teacher you could be, such so much better teacher, if you worked on yourself and got more willingness, then you'd just be able to help way more people. Another trick, right? Another trick that dupes us. Out of compassion, we think, yeah, if I worked on my willingness, I could really be compassionate and help more people. The whole time, we actually have the bliss that we need to do exactly what we need to do, and we don't do anything with it. The ego's been tricking us. And to really see this, you know, it hits you with like regret, and it stings, like you've just cut yourself. Ow! You know, wow! Which I did. I just cut myself yesterday. Did a really stupid thing. So the mood of repentance is super important. Otherwise, you're going to intellectualize the whole thing. But if you just see it, then right away you see it, and then, ouch! What an idiot I've been. Wasted my whole life. That is essentially the insight that you get to at this point when you're moving in towards you're becoming an apex yogin, as it were. The apex teachings. You get to the point where you realize you've wasted your entire life. Now, how do you handle that unless you're in this mood of repentance where you're expecting something really heavy to emerge, and you're ready for it? You're already somber, you know. I'm telling you, this is like the key, the answer, the key. And I've also said in my videos that a real civilization knows this and designs itself around this fact and encourages the mood of repentance in its citizens. A barbaric, regressive situation discourages it. Encourages frivolity, fun, parties, all this stuff, right? It discourages the mood of repentance, knowing full well that the ego then will keep tricking you. Absolutely. The ego knows when you get into a mood of repentance, you're going to be able to see how it's tricked you all this time, and that you've wasted your life. But instead of becoming distraught or depressed, you say, finally, this is great. Finally, I'm seeing this. I'll tell you this. I was talking with someone today who is a psychiatrist, and they were talking about the holidays and how everybody, you know, people get really bad problems during Thanksgiving and Christmas. And they were talking about how psychiatrists can't take any days off during the holidays, because he said so many people want to kill themselves over the holidays, okay? Super depressed. I'll tell you this. What is depression? Okay? I know the answer to that question. Depression is the suppression of the mood of repentance. That's exactly what it is. When you are not allowed to enter into the mood of repentance, okay, when culture pressures you not to do that, then you're aware that you're being deceived, that you're not doing what you need to do, and this causes enormous regrets within you. And when you're not allowed to be in the mood of repentance so that you can move past this, okay, then it gets stuck, this regret and anguish gets stuck within you as depression. So really, the cure for depression is to enter into the mood of repentance. It really is. And I can speak from this from the most incredible direct-hand experience, having suffered through just the unbelievable depression and super long-lasting and just seeming impossible to get rid of it. I'm now aware that it was merely the suppression of this mood of repentance. So I was incapable then of seeing the trick of the ego. And for me, it was so severe because I knew I was being tricked, but I was unable to get into the state which would enable me to see it. And, you know, and seeing it in the right way. So the depression was just horrific. So I can tell you this is the answer. It's not the brain chemicals, etc. That's secondary. It can become a vicious loop, okay? So, I mean, psychiatrists, it's a tough job, and they do the best job they can, okay? A lot of good people work in the mental health field, all right? But the real answer is the mood of repentance. That will dissipate your depression. Okay, if you're really depressed and down, there is a way to get out of it. I start out this morning saying, every morning if you can start out saying the continuity problem is the only problem I have. There's only one problem, and it's the continuity problem. That's what I do in the morning. Try to remember to do that. And you just keep doing that and keep doing that. You take a shower, get ready, eat. You know, there's only one problem, it's the continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. We have no other problem. No other problem than that. This centers you. And from that being centered that way, you're then able to start the day in this mood of repentance, like, okay, now, how is this continuity problem solved? Oh, okay. You get the day going right. You're able to have a mood of repentance, which means you anticipate and expect you're going to have great breakthroughs that day. And great breakthroughs mean you're going to see how you've been tricked, duped, you know, severely duped. And you've just been laboring and oppressed under this trickeration, which is not a real word, but we'll use it. And it's just like, oh, you know, it's just, it feels, if you're in the mood of repentance, the anguish doesn't hit you. It's very interesting. It's subdued. It's muted. It's very muted. It's concentration, diffuse concentration. You're just here. And say, I'm just here. Okay, whatever I see, just let it be. Don't attack it. Don't try to capture it. Don't try to do anything with it. You just say, okay, I saw that. So I've been practicing this for a long time. When I first started A Course in Miracles, I had the most horrific depression. And doctors, everybody completely had given up on me. Said, you're incurable. And the day I found the Course in Miracles, I knew I was going to get well. I said, the answers are, you know, somebody knows the answer, okay? He's got that feeling. There is an answer. And gradually, you know, it dissipated and dissipated over the years. As I practiced this, I didn't know the word for it, but I practiced just letting insights arise and then not trying to just, and the reactions, just letting them happen without trying to do anything about it, or you know, just, there's a way to simply mute it all, kind of. You just try to remain non-reactive. You just breathe, you just stay still, you don't take any action. You try not to have any reaction at all, really. You're not hating yourself or hating the ego, doing anything. Just say, okay, just let it be. But at the same time, you're not distracting your mind toward what's going on in the world. No, you're just right with it. And of course, you're part of you is boiling, yes. But you realize there's another part that's keeping the lid on. This is how you dissipate depression. And literally, what culture causes depression, actually, culture can cause depression, it does severely, is the more we go towards discouraging the mood of repentance, the worse depression gets in the world. And right now, you know, there's so many people suffering from depression, and what do they get? Prozac, or, you know, some drug, antidepressive. Which are actually very nasty medications. Really nasty medications. In my opinion, make it worse. The person may be more functional in some ways, and some people it helps. But it's You know, that's the sign of a barbaric society, regressive barbaric society. You see, the society that we have now is a regressive society. You know, the so-called quote-unquote progressives, that's a misnomer. They're actually regressives. We're regressing away from a high civilization where the mood of repentance was emphasized to a civilization that severely discourages this, even quasi-criminalizes it. And certainly ostracizes those who are looking in that direction. You feel this profound pressure on those who are looking in that direction. They're being ostracized, they're being demonized, they're being castigated. And quasi-criminality is floating all around them all the time, like they're fugitives. They probably feel like the Christians in the Roman times, they're feeling a need to, you know, dwell in the catacombs. And who knows how long it will be before persecution will take place. We already have legal persecution, and the persecutions continue on from that point. So, barbaric, regressive culture at this time in the world, getting worse all the time. More and more drugs. Everything's being treated with drugs. I'm telling you, that's the wrong approach. Not saying it should not be used in certain circumstances, okay? It's up to the doctors, etc. But, again, like for me, I just said, hey, this is not the way. This is never going to work. Let's get with it now. Let's do the work that really is going to work. Let's find out what really works, okay? But, at times, medications can be helpful. Like for me, for instance, there was a time when my anxiety was so terrible that I had to take this drug-like Valium. Valium-like drug for a while. It saved my life, actually. Saved my life. Because it was simply too much. So, keep that in mind. We're not saying excluding, you know, and some ancillary help. There are times when we need a crutch, sure. But the real cure is the mood of repentance for depression. That is the real cure. And the more we move society in that direction, the less depression there will be. The less mental illness there will be, for sure. For sure. No question about it. Basically, you can have a society where there is no mental illness. If the mood of society is very strongly oriented towards the mood of repentance, and that's as encouraged from cradle to grave, and people get it, you're going to have very, very minimal mental health problems, as well as emotional problems, as well as mental problems, actually. You know, the whole thing, the whole constellation is going to be much less problematical. Because whatever arises, you can say, okay, the continuity problem is the only problem anyone has. See, your reality has no problem whatsoever. It has no problem whatsoever. Now, the belief that reality has a problem, that belief then has a continuity problem because you have to drop it. It's completely untrue, will always be untrue. So there's nothing you can do except to drop that idea. But that notion, that whim. But you have a continuity issue if you've held on to it for a long time, like you believe that reality really has a problem and you're trying to solve it or get free of reality because it has a problem. You have a continuity problem. And so that's what needs to be addressed. That's what we need to focus on. And when you realize that you're really trying to solve the continuity problem, then you're not afraid to look at how the ego has tricked you. So you get into the mood of repentance, you see how the ego's tricked you, and you say, great, now I see it. It doesn't scare me. That's mental health, you see. That is real mental health when you're able to do that. The real gurus are actually experts on mental health. They absolutely know how to cure the mental health problems of people. It's not a quick fix, though, you see. And the problem is our society is so geared to productivity of decoration of pure spaciousness that, you know, the cure, they want the cure to be quick. They want you to have to be productive, right? You have to be organized. You have to be doing things all the time. You have to be active, productive, productive, producing. This is just decorations in pure spaciousness, actually. With the belief that if we make enough of it, we will somehow be the origin of pure spaciousness. All these decorations that dwell in pure spaciousness, we think, no, those are primary, and pure spaciousness comes later, you know, which is delusion. So, this kind of culture doesn't allow anyone to spend the necessary time to get well. They just give you drugs. Get back on your feet and get working, you know, soldier. It's like the soldiers, you know, in the wars, I'm telling you. I mean, the Germans pump their soldiers full of methamphetamine. Okay, absolutely. Now, they were just like totally wired out of their minds, and it just caused incredible mental health problems for the soldiers. And so, you know, and Benny's or, you know, Speed, all that stuff was the Allies. Everybody was using that. Caffeine, cigarette, Speed, go, 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 go. And then we're in this go-go culture. We're in a go-go culture. And you get, you know, the go-go girls, they dance, come on, go, 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 go. The cheerleader, the go-go girls, say, hey, culture, go, 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 go. And the problem is, like, for me, I wanted to spend my life in the mood of repentance, knowing it's the way to salvation. And I got all this acculturation hitting me saying, hey, no, go, 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 go. You gotta, come on, you can't do that. Don't be an oddball, don't be an outcast. Don't be antisocial. I was called antisocial, I wasn't antisocial. I was very social, but I was saying, hey, you know, this is what needs to be done. Let's stop this other stuff. Just, you know, sit, be quiet, and be aware and focused and expect great insight and clarity to come. So, but nobody, you know, nobody was like, what, you know, you're crazy, this oddball, loner, you know, all this stuff. So it was terrible. That led to depression. Too much cultural pressure, all right? And so the more geared you are to the mood of repentance, the tougher it is in this culture, and the more likely you are to get depression and mental illness and mental dis-ease, stress, mental stress of various types, which really just come from this frustration and upset and anguish that you're suffering needlessly, you know. And you can see everybody's suffering needlessly, actually. Why? I'll tell you why. Because everything is, all decorations are already abiding in pure spaciousness, and you can allow them to fall into themselves. And what is this falling into? It's actually falling into pure spaciousness. Like clouds dissolving, clouds coalescing and then dissolving. They're dissolving into pure spaciousness. So everything is already enlightened in pure spaciousness. So you can actually perceive this. That's what I call a healed perception. That solves the continuity problem. It's the smoothness of everything just as it is being somehow perceived, that it's falling into itself, falling into pure spaciousness. You know, it's there, but it's also falling. For instance, you throw a ball up and you see the ball, and you're seeing the ball, and if you're fixated just on the ball, you're seeing a ball. But if you pull back into big sky awareness, you see a ball falling through spaciousness, right? Different perspective. So we see things, but if we could pull back to the big sky awareness, pure spacious awareness, we'd see things falling into pure spaciousness everywhere. Everything, the entire universe is falling into pure spaciousness right this minute, every second. That is from a perceptual standpoint. You see, that solves the continuity problem. There's a higher standpoint, but we can't get to it until we have our perception healed. Because ultimately, you drop perception altogether, and then you realize it's all just pure spaciousness. But that's a knowing, it's not a perceiving. You can't perceive that. You cannot perceive it. It's too high of a goal. it's not a goal we should aim for. We should aim for healed perception. That's what Jesus tells us, and I believe he's absolutely right about that. Healed perception solves a continuity issue between believing that things are somehow causal, separate things that are not, that are in a chain of causation that is somehow not yet in pure spaciousness. That's what we're seeing. We think there's this world, all this stuff is happening, and we don't, and we think that it's yet to be determined what the ground of being is. It's yet to be determined because all this stuff's going on, right? Nothing's going on. It's in terms of our ground of being, in terms of God, pure spaciousness, prime creator, nothing is happening at all that affects that in any way. But we take it that everything that's happening in the world is somehow is affecting God, you know. It's not. So that's what I mean, saying nothing is happening. Sure, on the superficial, there's all this movement. Sure, there's a lot of that movement. But in terms of meaning, there's nothing happening. So it's not like you'll lose sight of meaning when you see everything falling into pure spaciousness. That's when you actually gain meaning. That's when you see the meaning that's always been there. But we're just overlooking it. We're just overlooking it. And who gets us? The ego gets us to overlook it, saying, because we see it, and the ego says, congratulations. You've seen a little bit of it because you had a little bit of willingness. But just think what you would do if you had a lot of willingness. Then you really see it. And you go, oh yeah, I better go back to work. Fooled, tricked, right there. What you need to say is, no ego, this is all I need. All I need to do is solve the continuity problem. And this solves the continuity problem for me. I only need a little bit of willingness to see this. And so I'm not gonna drop it. That is what you have to say. So that is why I'm telling you the continuity problem is the only problem there is. That's all we have to aim for. And all that takes is a little bit of willingness to perceive a little bit differently. Big sky awareness. It's not so difficult. Like I said, like you see some birds flying through the sky and you have binoculars or video camera and you're looking at them and all you see is the birds, right? And then you drop the binoculars or video camera and you look and see the whole expanse of the sky and you still see the birds flying, but now you see where the birds are. Before you didn't know where they were. You couldn't see the spaciousness, but now you see the spaciousness. You say, ah, yeah, the birds are flying in the spaciousness, as is the plane and the clouds, and it's all in the same spaciousness, all everything. That's all. It's very, very simple. Just a little bit of willingness is all you need for that. Now, who are the great gurus, right? Who are the great saviors? They're literally the ones who saw through the ego's trick and used just a little bit of willingness. Those are actually great gurus. And the ego tricks you and says, look, look what you did with a little bit of willingness. And you see this, amazing. Just think what you could do with a lot of willingness. You'd be a really great guru, you know. You'd be incredibly great. And then you think, oh yeah, I could be more helpful. Trick. So the great gurus are the ones that say, no ego, this is all I need. All I need to do is to this continuity problem be resolved. All I need to do is be reminded of reality, which is healed perception reminds us of reality. And then from there, God will take the final step and, you know, bring me into pure knowing. And at that point, I will be a great guru. But so the great gurus are the ones who are willing to be the not great gurus. Okay? that's a paradox. You see the paradox there, how that is. Because they're the ones that succeed. The great gurus are the ones that have succeeded. And how do you succeed? By rejecting the ego's temptation to be a great guru. That's how you succeed. Just a little willingness is all any of us need. A little willingness, that's it. It's a willingness to go from fixating on an object to seeing the object in its spacious context. That's all. That's all we need to do. That's it. Nothing more. And nothing has to happen in order to do that. The motion, no motion, no particular motion has to happen, nor does it have to not happen in order for us to do this. everything is already, all motion is within pure spaciousness, it's already there. So there's nothing needs to happen for you to see the context of it. You know, it's like the birds flying through the sky, flock of birds. You know, the birds don't have to fly at a certain speed for you to realize that they're flying in the sky, right? But if you're fixated on, okay, how fast are those birds going? Now, I need them to go just a little bit faster, or I need them to slow down just a little bit. Birds are not quite, this doesn't matter. They're going slow, they're still in the same spaciousness. They're going fast, same spaciousness. Doesn't matter how they're flapping their wings or anything. You know, so it doesn't matter what the motion is, all the motion that's going on, which we call the universe, doesn't matter. It's all intrinsically within the same pure spaciousness as it's always been, so, and always will be. So you don't have to be calculating anything. There's no calculations are necessary. None. So if you can kind of feel this, that's apex yoga really. We're going into the apex yoga, apex teachings, the high teachings. And why not? Why not? There's no reason not to. But it does take the mood of repentance. It does take it because you realize, oh my gosh, all this time I've been calculating how fast the birds are flying. Totally stupid. See? You don't need any mathematics to be enlightened. You just need to shift your perspective. And you say, what an idiot I've been. What a total idiot. Oh my gosh, I could always have seen it this way. It's just unbelievable. But believe it's true that we have been, you know, tricked. Why? Because we want to be greater than God. We want to be prior to spaciousness. So that's why we want to have more. You know, no, I need more willingness. I want to be a greater guru. I want to, you know, the ego easily tricks us because of our own desire to be greater than God. That's why we get tricked. So when you see these fundamental tricks, don't try and extrapolate from them. Nothing needs to be calculated or extrapolated or worked out. You saw it, that's it. And then you just dwell in the aftermath of seeing it. Don't let mental activity try to deal with it. You're already in the mood of repentance, let that mood deal with it. See, let the mood deal with it, not your thinking. Not your calculating. The calculation is a waste of time. Superficially, we use it for technology and all sorts of stuff, but as far as meaning goes, it's a waste of time. No calculation is necessary. No judgment is necessary either, right? No judgment is necessary. So we're getting helped out by various teachers, really. They're all adding their help and flavor to it all. And very, very, very great teachers are helping us, actually. This Longchenpa is a really, you know, just a very great teacher. Really has the clarity. Succinct clarity, you know. Unwavering clarity. Non-pulsating, oscillating clarity. No question about it. He's truly sees all pulsation and oscillation, in other words, all movement, subtle, whatever, everything, as simply all just pure spaciousness. And just a magical display that's really ultimately meaningless, just decorations. Totally clear about that, and so it's helpful, very helpful. So we're getting helped, so it's not like we're going to fail, but the mood of repentance has to be cultivated, has to be super important. And again, it's tough in this society, very tough, but it can be done. But I'm looking forward to a new era, a new epic, a new place, somewhere where a culture, civilization, it encourages the mood of repentance, because then it will be a lot easier. There's no question about it. This present world, the direction it's going in, spiritual disaster. Can't end well the way it's going. We are just radically discouraging the mood of repentance. Which is why, the warnings of Fatima, and throughout history, warnings, repent. Russia must repent. In other words, communism must repent. The ideology of materialistic consumerism must repent. Otherwise, there's going to be catastrophe on this planet, involving the sun and, various factors. But, meaning this materialistic, humanistic consumerism, where manufacture, production, like for robots, is horrendously regressive. The persecution of religion is horrendously regressive. And of course, it's all being done in the name of being progressive. And of course, we know history. I don't want to pick on any people or country or anything like that, because it's greater than that. But certainly the disease is in this planet most severely, and being spread throughout the whole planet. Of be busy, be occupied, be productive, be calculating, be constantly reacting, be defending, be attacking, be reactive. All these video games and apps and all these things that people are doing on their smartphones and their tablets and their computers and their Xboxes, etc., etc., etc. All that stuff is training you in exactly the wrong direction. The real training is to not have that stuff, really. I mean, we're using technology here in the right way, actually, which can be done. But it's really not necessary. Because all you have to do is simply abide in the mood of repentance, and automatically clarity will arise, automatically. And then you'll see, oh my gosh, I've just been duped, that's all. And you see, you can get free of that. That don't even need books, don't need anything, just that mood. And it's said that there are those who are living frivolous lives, a barbaric, regressive, frivolous lives, and they came across a sage, a saint, a yogi, a master, a guru, savior, avatar, a Buddha, etc. And a rishi, and their mood changed instantly. Their mood changed, and they became very much changed. What is the change? Mood of repentance hit them, because they said, "Oh my gosh, they have what I really want. What I have isn't what I really want. I'm being tricked." And it shocked them, And they said, "I got to get serious. I got to anticipate getting free of this, state I'm in." Yeah, just like that. People talk all the time, the testimony narrative of history is people coming across these sages, etc., that, and they say, my life was just instantly changed. I just changed. I just hit so strongly, just said, oh my gosh. And never the same again. They right then and there, the spiritual path began for them. And it's true, absolutely true. You say, hey, I better get serious. This is serious. I'm something's wrong with me. I'm being tricked. I gotta find out how am I being tricked? I gotta find this out. And then the struggle begins, And the ego tries to distract you and move you away from that mood of repentance. Again, the mood of repentance enables clarity, clarification to arise. It is, so it's kind of like lessening the density. How can you say this? The pressure, like if you have water, heavy water, and there's something, then that something can rise up, lessen the density. It's able to rise. So as you get in this mood of repentance, the clarity arises, and you become aware of it. You say, "Hey, I see that now. How come I didn't see it before?" You say, "I see it, but ouch! Wow! I've been wasting my time. I've been wasting my life." Essentially, that's what it is. I've been wasting my life. I've wasted my life. Better to realize it now than later. When Jesus says, "Die before you die, be born again," and Nanai Ma says, "Death must die." It really means that you realize you've been living a lie. You've been dead, as it were, to truth. You've been duped. You've wasted your life. Your life has been like death, really. And I can say that my life has been like, I've been dead. I haven't been alive. I've been like dead. Tricked by the ego. That's what they're talking about. And once you see this, then you can be, quote unquote, reborn. You're resurrected from the dead, actually. Because then you say, all I need is a little bit of willingness. I see healed perception. I see everything falling into itself, into its ground of being. There's some sort of healed perception. I see it. That reminds me of reality. And I'm no longer afraid to let go of perception altogether at some point. And you're healed. You're healed. No more chance, possibility of mental illness or sickness. No more possibility of it. Freed of it. Freed of suffering. Freed of misery. Free of it, absolutely. Just a little bit of willingness is all that it takes. And here, everyone in the world is frantically working to get more than a little bit of willingness. I'm telling you, that is the truth. We all have this little bit of willingness already, but we're frantically pursuing greater willingness that we don't even need. It's all a complete waste of time. We could spend a billion years and still the remedy be exactly the same, and we could have done it a billion years ago. You see, just completely wasted a billion years for no reason. Literally. So imagine if you spend a billion years, the regret that you'll feel, you know. You need to be in to practice the mood of repentance so you can see it and say, "Okay, I've just wasted a billion years." All right? I said, you don't do anything with it. Factually, to see it, state it, that's what it is. Just a fact, okay? I just wasted a billion years. And just abide with that. You're just abiding. Just abidance with the clarification, the mood of repentance. So I'm advocating, I'm telling you that this is all important. If you really want to be freed of all troubles, including all mental illness, all sufferings, if you really want to be resurrected from the dead, if you really want death to die, all of that, got to practice this mood of repentance. You have to look for it. You have to do it. You have to get very sober. You have to anticipate. You have to have faith that you are going to get the insights, and therefore being in this mood is worth it. Otherwise, the ego will say, "Well, why are you wasting your time? You should be out having fun. Why are you sitting there, you know, all very subdued, you know, like over in a corner, just looking down at the ground, you know? Why are you doing that? Stupid. You should be out having fun. Celebrate life," the ego says. The ego's constantly marketing, "Celebrate your life. Come on, get out and dance your life, you know." Dance, 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 right? Ego's always saying, "Come on, get out there and dance." And you're saying, "I've been there, done that, and it didn't work for me." I'm saying, just sit there. Don't do anything. Just abide in this mood of repentance, and you will find out that you never needed to do anything in the first place. You already had a little bit of willingness, and you never need to suffer at all, and you don't need to suffer anymore. See, that's what you need. Okay, so forget about all the fun and the dance and all that stuff, the big dance. You don't have to attend the dance. I never attended dances. Never. And growing up and going through, you know, all that, no, I never went to any dances. I said, forget it. I'm going to read, you know, I'm going to sit here and read something very profound. I'm going to try and, you know, how can I get free of misery? So it's not going to necessarily happen overnight, although it could. You literally could get it right now. Anybody could. And maybe you will. Some of us are slower than others, because maybe we've been duping ourselves for a long, long time. So it's like, wow, it's a really heavy, heavy thing to realize I've just wasted all my life. Not this life, but many lives. All my lives, actually, are just a complete waste. Total waste. Meaningless. Utterly meaningless. Many, many, many lives. All of them. So some will just say, ah, okay, I repent, I get it, and they will then awaken. Their perception will be healed. Others will take longer. But I tell you this, that you should get with it right now, because chances are it may take a while. So, you know, you better not waste time avoiding it. It's like getting on a diet. You know, I'm on a diet now, and it's hard to get on a diet. But, you know, once you start, you better stay on it, because it may take a while to lose those pounds. It may take a while before you can really feel comfortable seeing the heart of the delusion, because it's like so simple. He said, good grief. It's not the complexity that hurts, that stings. It's the simplicity. You just say, that is just like so utterly easy and obvious. I mean, how could I ever have missed that? That's what stings. So what the ego does, when you're not in the mood of repentance, the ego says, hey, you don't need that mood of repentance. I'll explain it to you. And then it gives some really complex explanation. And you say, oh, okay, I understand how I might have not got that. So that's why I'm feeling bad. Okay, it's no big deal. That doesn't sting. And it's also not the answer. What stings is to see how utterly basic and obvious it's always been, and you've just been missing. It's like you've been searching for eons for something so desperately, and it's like you've been dying of thirst for so long and just horrible suffering. All the while, you had a bottle of water in your hand the entire time. You just never drank it. You know, it's that stupid. So it takes a lot of practice with repentance to be able to finally accept that. You know, it's just like, and again, the ego deceives us by saying, no, your problem is really complex, and that's how you dig through it. You'll never get there as long as you see it as complex. You'll never get into a mood of repentance. You'll be searching, reading, you know, trying to figure out everything. It's just like really, really complex, all this stuff. And it's not. It's not at all. Everything is already totally abiding in pure spaciousness, as it always has. There isn't any problem. So it is actually completely simple and basic. That's the hard part. And the ego, again, leads us astray by trying to get us into complexity, and all this esoteric complexity. Longchenpa says, forget it. Don't need any of it. Truth, very simple. Everything is intrinsically already abiding in pure spaciousness. All those nine steps, all this esoteric, all this stuff, again, forget it. Never needed it. But people go through it anyway, so you might as well, you know. I mean, most people are going to get fooled anyway, so they make these steps, okay? But ultimately, you realize that even all those steps were simply just ego tricking you. It's all just been tricked. We've just been tricked. That's it. And the apex yoga is simply the final realization. Yeah, it was all just deception. It was just all a waste of time. But being able to see that is the practice of apex yoga. So that's what we're doing now. That is literally what we're doing. We're practicing apex yoga. Which is a great place to be. It's the place to be, as a matter of fact. It is the place to be. if you're going to be anywhere, if you think of yourself being anywhere, this is the place to be. We're practicing apex yoga, and this is what actually works. Just realization, you realize I've just been completely wasting my time, utterly, absolutely 100%, nothing but a waste of time. Never had to ever separate from bliss or suffer, you know, anything. Never. Yeah, these deep, you know, real seeing this, that is the practice of apex yoga. You don't go anywhere other than that. Fundamentally duped. I had the water in my hand the whole time. That's it. And just continuously focusing on that. The mood of repentance. Allowing yourself to see this. More than just hearing it conceptually. But actually, you can literally realize it. You realize, I've always had it. I just was looking for more. Because we didn't realize we had a continuity problem, you see? We didn't realize. You see, it crept up on us. See, there is this thing that it... That's why I say the continuity problem is central. So I'd say the only problem I have is a continuity problem. This is like a profession of faith. The ground profession of faith, the very first step, is I have a continuity problem. All right? It's like AA says, I have a drinking problem. But the spiritual AA is like, I have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. Most people don't realize that. Most spirits don't realize that. It creeps up like a cancer, slowly, you know. The more we believe reality as a problem, the more of a continuity problem we have, because we're afraid to set it down, which we must do. So, first, I have a continuity problem. That opens the door for a boot of repentance. That opens the door to realizing that all along we've had the little bit of willingness that all is all we need. That little bit of accepting that leads to healed perception, which resolves the continuity problem. And that's it. And that's it for this video. Very great.